Welcome to Africa Works E Squared, your podcast about education, employment, employability, and entrepreneurship in Africa and how they go together. My name is Jörg, co-founder of Africa Works, and I'm glad you're back to listen to our second episode. Today is going to be about taking the next step, and that means approaching the issue of job searching. This means after we dealt with the background against which things are taking place, we are now taking a look at what's happening on stage and where and how you're going to be entering that stage. For that matter, I want to provide you with an overview of what I believe is worth giving a shot. Obviously, you may want to deviate from it, but in any case, you will find out that it is both about outreach and exposure, which relates back to our career planning principles from our first episode. Let's start out by taking a look at some figures that I collected. According to an empirical study called Higher Education and Work in Africa, the ages and time of graduation by field of study and country vary, did you know? Ages of 24 and 26. Sometimes higher, sometimes lower, especially higher in life sciences. And in Kenya, the average is about 24.4 years. What matters here is that over half of graduates in Kenya, and also Uganda and Tanzania, by the way, they begin the job searching process before graduation. What I'm saying here, you're going to have to answer for yourself what time period suits you best, but in order to be on the safe side, it's wise not to be late. So let's go deeper here now. Generally speaking, one can distinguish between four different ways of seeking employment after graduation. There's active search, there is employment agencies, there is university contacts, and there is personal contacts. Active search covers, say, strategies where you as a graduate take action and apply without any external assistance, at least for the first big action and apply without any external assistance, at least for the first part. And then second, there's employment agencies, which includes public agencies as well as private recruiting companies. And then again, third, university, and fourth, personal contacts. Now we're going to go more into detail here in a few minutes, but just to give you a good first impression, according to the numbers, active search strategies are at the top with an average of at least 40%. Employment agencies follow second with 33%, and then third come personal contacts with 18%. University contacts, and that is interesting from a systematic point of view, only account for 10%. That includes professors, but also career services. Personal contacts, again, and this is worth mentioning, are especially relevant for those with a degree in the humanities and arts, social sciences, and agriculture. Mostly means family, friends, friends of family, and friends of friends. So that direction. And the reason is, that's my educated guess, most likely rooted in the fact that the labor market needs is not as extensive in these areas, especially from the private sector. When considering those four groups of job search strategies, as I call them, it makes sense to align them with each other and consider them as clusters that often end up being somehow connected and intertwined. Don't just look at them separately. Take personal contacts, for example. They may be the reason for you to start an active job searching process, or it may even be the other way around. So again, I would advise you not to look at them exclusively, but for matters of effectiveness, use several of them at the same time, as long as, and here I'm referring to our E-squared episode number one, as long as you focus and prioritize. Be that as it may, outreach and exposure is what equally matters, because if you reach out and if you expose yourself, you are more likely to master the laws of job search today, meaning you won't struggle with them as much in the future, say 10 years from now. Much of what I will be talking about may not be new for you, but what may be new is my, let's say, rational and straightforward critique on what, at least according to my experience, works and what does not. Because, and this is already a teaser for our next episode, I will at least try to I will prove everything by what is common in practice, which means I will mirror my statements and pieces of advice from the company's perspective, from the employer's perspective, which is why the next episode is also going to be about the employer's point of view. This is very important. I mean, at the end of the day, it's what counts, employment, and hence no jobs and no employees. And I simply believe that lots of advice is out there that does not reflect on the business's needs, on their perspective and internal realities. So let us dive in here. First, when it comes to job search, I'm not making a distinction between digital and non-digital. That would be a little shallow and also useless because I want to give you my two cents of what I believe works most effectively. And there are some good old non-digital mechanisms that I believe everyone should try. Hence, my distinction is much rather between linear and interactive mechanisms or linear and interactive methods. So let's talk about linear first. When talking about linear or non-interactive methods, what do I mean? Well, here we are looking at the single job or job description that companies like to put on the web. Somewhere out there on the internet, you will find a job ad. And mainly it's as a part of their career section on their own website. We've all seen this. And on a side note, this equally applies to a job board at your university, or it may equally apply to a handout from your career service contact person. It works the same. So most of you probably use a job search portal, let's say like Brighter Monday or Fuzu, or even a job search engine that uses crawlers to search through job search portals like Brighter Monday or Fuzu at the same time. And that will give you an even bigger load of results. They are paid by companies to put the ads online, and then you go online and you type in what you're looking for, and then it will be presented to your screen. Some of you also have a list of their favorite companies, and they visit their websites frequently, be that as it may, of a company's website. And in any case, I call these strategies linear because the way to reach that particular job, it's like a one-way street, and therefore it's non-interactive. I mean, there may be a number there that you can call or an email that you can send your questions to, but that's not what I mean. It's non-interactive because it works like the good old billboard. Or to make it even clearer, it's a search and request by the sender of the message, in this case, that's the company, to an unknown crowd, an undesignated group of recipients to essentially hand in their anonymous offers. And then that company can choose whether they want to act on this offer or on these offers or not. And it's pretty flat, but it's also very one-dimensional. And in fact, it's not smart at all. Believe it or not, this is still the most frequently used method of sourcing candidates and hiring people by employers worldwide. And the more specific an inquiry by a company gets, the larger the needle haystack issue gets, of course. Now, when should you apply for a specific job that is advertised in such a job description? Well, first of all, too often we see people apply first, think later. Apply first and think later. What do I mean by that? Well, such a tactic is known as spray and pray. As much as I understand, the laws of your labor markets, Kenyan labor market, Nigerian labor market and their competitiveness, the thin air and all that, I want to tell you what is wrong about spray and pray in the first place. Sending the same CV out to 50 companies and hoping for the best is the worst decision you can make in terms of energy and time. Because, as we will learn in a later episode on delivering a convincing, you need to keep adapting your CV to each role that you're applying for. There's simply no way around that. And it doesn't have to mean major adjustments, but in any case, the one-size-fits-all principle is the wrong way. Second, and probably just as important, is also the fact that all those rejections will naturally hurt your ego. And that is totally understandable. And it's going to prevent you from doing what I talked about in episode one, namely reflect, connect, and reaffirm. Now, what does that mean? It essentially means that if you find that your profile matches the job description at hand to at least 60%, then you can give it a shot. This 60% rule is something that has developed over the years, I'd say throughout the recruiting world. Obviously, some HR managers are stricter than others. And of course, it depends on the feedback, on the quality of application dossiers that they receive. But depending on that, your chances start increasing exponentially once you've hit those 60%. So there are studies that show that almost half of employers would consider a candidate who only applies to 3 or 5 qualifications sought. And those are your 60%. Unfortunately, there are still too many HR managers and recruiters and CEOs out there that expect you to at least formally match their expectations with a quota of 90%. But let me tell you that this is a futile approach anyway. However, I have to say that this is also yet another big issue, another big problem that easily brings us enough content for an entire episode. All in all, when interpreting the job description at hand that you are looking at currently, the most important criteria are typically ranked at the top. Of each category. Categories such as you bring, or your background, or your skill set, or your experience. This is what you're supposed to bring along, right? They bring you closest to 100% match. And independent of the fact that there hardly ever exists such a 100% person, you being able to fulfill the top criteria mentioned in those sections brings you already quite close to achieving the 60%. Obviously, if you're looking at several job descriptions at the same time, and in one you consider your own score to be higher, you want to focus on those. Prepare for those, design your strategy for those primarily. So let's continue with our applications to job ads online. Now, you may be wondering why I still sound a little reluctant here when it comes to this linear approach, these linear strategies. By far not my most favorite advice to students, to graduates, to young professionals on how to apply. And if you ask me, if I had to apply for a job today, this would not be the method I would be using, at least not exclusively, at least not in its purest form. But I will come to that later, because there is obviously a snag. And the snag here is that this job ad out there that we're currently looking at, it's for anyone to respond to, literally anyone. And together with you, it may be your entire class of 2020, and that is just your university. I mean, there are going to be criteria mentioned in the job description, but that has never really prevented anyone, at least from my experience here at Africa Works, from throwing their hat in the ring. We have had so many applications from people who believe that they are fit, who believe that their profile matches the qualification criteria, So you may be wondering, what else is there for me to do? If that's the case, well, in terms of effectiveness, if you choose to apply to an online job ad, you should at least think about how you can boost the effectiveness of that particular application. So suppress your urge to apply right away. Instead, you might want to do some research first as to whether somebody in your network may have a connection to the job at hand. Second, whether somebody in your network happens to know somebody who knows somebody who works at the company. So you see where I'm going with this. You can check that on social media. Maybe somebody from your network has shared the JD already, the job description, and who can be a potential gate opener for you, somebody who you can contact. And well, then you might want to listen to episode number 1 again here. People are when they know you. When it comes to these online job search methods, I should not leave matching platforms unmentioned either. There are more innovative platforms on the rise nowadays that work with what is called matching algorithms. DumaWorks, for example, in Kenya works differently from classical job portals, because you give them your profile, you provide them with the data, And then they will use that to see whether there is a congruence with the jobs that they host as a provider. And then that means their algorithm basically provides you with proposals. This is still linear because it's not per se interactive, but what makes matching platforms interesting is that they are more responsive. The platform will send you an alert message when there is a job out there that matches your criteria. So you want to keep your eyes open for similar platforms where you can upload your CV and enter your data, because I'm sure that there will be a diversification data, because I'm sure that there will be a diversification in terms of industries and areas in the future. Now that I talked a great deal about linear mechanisms, let's turn to interactive options, or at least more interactive options. And obviously, social media profiles is what pops up and what should be next on the list. There is, in fact, more and more recruiting by companies through semi-professional social media channels. By semi-professional, I mean such as Facebook, even Twitter, and even Instagram. And naturally, there is purely professional platforms that need to be separated from those. And they are basically all about recruiting and business, typically LinkedIn. First of all, Facebook. Job search through specific Facebook groups can be a possible channel into your strategy. But please be careful. The vast majority, some say over 90% of recruiters, say that they check their applicants' social media profiles before hiring them, and up to 55 say they found content that caused them not to hire a person afterwards. This is devastating, and this is most times related to semi-professional networks, especially Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and the like. Which means, especially for the Facebook fans out there, what you put on the net stays on the net, in principle. I mean, there's exceptions, but in principle. I am the last person to call seriousness a virtue, but someone who is intending to give you money for your services, and that is a great deal of what employment is about, from their point of view, all this is a very serious issue. And that means your photos, but also the same with political statements. Personal opinions even, and anything else that goes down that road. Be careful here. When we talk about semi-professional social media channels, we also need to talk about profile pictures. Your profile picture, your photo album on Facebook in general is something you want to take a look at. When was the last time you checked your privacy settings? Also an important question. Same with WhatsApp. I once told a candidate that she cannot use a funny Snapchat photo as her profile picture on WhatsApp while she's in the recruiting cycle with a client, because the HR manager may contact her through WhatsApp. And especially for students and graduates, this is a tough one sometimes, I know, but you simply want to be on the safe side. I also once talked to a recruiter in Kenya, and she told me that one might even want to be careful about using Bible quotes. If you want to know my personal opinion, your vision to make it public, that's also your decision. I would personally not refrain from hiring you if you bring all the qualifications along. However, this is only me, and I do know that if it's an international company, you might want to keep in mind that simply a professional headshot may just make more sense, okay? Now, let's turn to content. As you are carefully listening, you heard me distinguish between semi-professional and professional platforms. And the reason is, quite frankly, that I advise you to strictly separate between the two as well. One is for your private activities and can, at times, be helpful for job search. For example, Facebook groups, I mentioned it. The other is for your professional activities and should be used for job search. Now, why that separation? Because it helps you focus. It helps you to focus and to target, and hence better reflect on how you present yourself while you're doing that. Let's turn to LinkedIn. Many people ask me, do I have to be on LinkedIn? And my answer is no, not if you're happy with the way things are working out for you. For everyone else, yes, sign up, give it a try. Now, it's not just about being on LinkedIn. Everyone can create a profile, call themselves innovator, and remain invisible. But becoming visible requires your personal brand and sales strategy, depending on your reflection and, again, reaffirmation. And that is just what turns social media into an interactive. What kind of person do you want to be in the eyes of companies, entrepreneurs, colleagues, startups, recruiters, and so on? What kind of content do you want to communicate? Who do you want to get in touch with? What I'm saying is, if you use LinkedIn, use it actively. Don't be passive. A colleague of mine even once said the fastest way to actually get a job is by approaching the CEO directly on LinkedIn or have somebody introduce you to the CEO directly on LinkedIn. I'm not sure if this is a statement that applies to anyone, but well, here you go. This is a possibility. And if you do, you also want to have a profile that is clean, clearly structured, and puts perfectly in a nutshell what skills you have and what you have to offer. So what should be your first step? You can sign up with a few friends, and for a start, you can all confirm each other's skills and competencies. You can ask others for short references that will show up in your profile. They do boost your credibility. And those just have to be 3 sentences long, nothing major, no essays. And you can put in your certificates, etc., etc. Next, you can do more research on how to use LinkedIn effectively, who to approach and how, and this is where it becomes interactive. There are many articles, many blogs out there that will surely provide great tips that will help you increase your visibility even further. One more aspect, and this is regarding personal contacts. Even at this early stage, you can raise the interest of recruiters. I'm not only talking about in-house HR managers, but external recruiters, headhunters that work for private recruiting companies, who again work for companies because they're being paid, just like what we do. They may see you, so you can consider them your allies in the process. What's important to mention here is that external recruiters do not hire graduates very often, but every now and then they do, because the companies they work for explicitly ask them to scout and source for young professionals. So all I'm saying is, you never know. One last word on LinkedIn. There is training providers out there who teach you how to adapt your LinkedIn profile accordingly, who tell you what to put in your profile in terms of skills and competencies in order for you, and here's the clue, be found faster by recruiters, both in-house and external. Because the matching algorithms used by recruiters and HR managers on LinkedIn, they are based on buzzwords. And the way those trainings work is that you are explained how to adapt the wording of your profile because recruiters and HR how to adapt the wording of your profile because recruiters and HR managers work with such buzzwords. Some even go as far as saying that buzzword clouds are the best way to be found. Well, let me tell you, if this is what you want to invest your money in, go ahead. But you need to make sure that you stay on top of the process, meaning in accordance with what I recommended in our first episode. Reflecting and reaffirming are particularly important when it comes to these kinds of services. And let me tell you, much more important than telling you how to pimp your LinkedIn profile with buzzwords is you knowing yourself, knowing where your strengths lie. Okay? By far, the most interactive method of job search is networking. I didn't say effective, but interactive. We have meetups, we have career fairs, we have trade fairs, we have you name it, you know? And this is also where, as I said before, strategies are often intertwined because there is a personal contact that, and this is the idea behind it, helps you skip the line. The reason I'm so reluctant to recommend linear tools like job portals is because you're going to be the 489th person in line. And what is important to understand is that somewhere, somebody, somehow can provide you with a fast pass to skip the line. That's what you want. Now, what does that mean? More and more companies are exhibiting in public, and there are career fairs out there that help you make first contact. It's a good forum to practice your self-presentation and public speaking skills, because career fairs are also for the sake of learning. They're also there for you to see, also for the sake of learning. They're also there for you to see what's out there in general. You don't have to make a perfect impression yet. So when going to a career fair, you still want to make sure you bring your CV and your professional business cards. And on that note, I even had one candidate tell me they printed themselves business cards with photos and headshots on them. So they took a picture of themselves and printed it on the business cards. And I thought this was kind of a memorable thing. It may sound funny, but amidst the tons of people that those companies are talking to, you are going to be remembered because of your photo. Now, my personal favorite when it comes to interactive job search methods is actually trade fairs. Trade fairs are not only industry specific and therefore narrowed down to your favorite field of expertise, they are also a great way to network. Same here, bring your business cards and have your seats. Trade fairs, not all exhibiting companies are hiring, but there is a trend. There is a trend to more openness for candidate sourcing whilst exhibiting at a trade fair, because people like you have been showing up over the years and this made the round. So most importantly, the people at the respective company booth, and this is what counts, they're in an above average mood. Let's talk about the opposite scenario here. Let's pretend you just call the company. You ask for the vacancy and you have Mrs. XYZ on the phone. She doesn't have the time. She doesn't have the willingness to assist you. You're stealing her time. You are way too intrusive on whatever she's currently working on, etc., etc. So trade fairs are the exact opposite, because the people there are away from their desks. They are off work, so to speak. They want to showcase their company. They want to engage. They're interested in visitors. They want to engage. They're interested in visitors. They want to have a good time. And now most times it may not be the hiring manager that they send, but rather salespeople and marketing experts. However, this can be your entry point, because these guys know where the company's strategy is headed. And they're also very often in touch with HR issues. They may know about traineeship programs. They may know about possible job openings or any other kind of detail that could be of interest to you. I had a Kenyan coachee once, a job applicant, who told me that he went to an agricultural trade show in Nairobi and ended up connecting with 50 people on LinkedIn and now has a job because a marketing person from the company booth connected with him on LinkedIn later. And he saw there was a job opening from that person and he used that to get back in the game. And the introduction by that line, again, skip the line. Obviously, it had helped tremendously that, as he told me later, he had put on a nice business shirt, he had his business cards ready, and he obviously liked to engage the companies. When you decide to attend a trade fair, make sure you define your own goals for that day. How many people do you want to exchange cards with? Who do you want to talk to? Etc., etc. This will help. Last, I don't want to leave meetups unmentioned. Meetups are typically industry related, or they are narrowed down to a specific type of business, such as startups. And often the people who speak at such events or who are guests on the podium are multipliers. Some would even say influencers. Anyway, they have experience, they have knowledge, they are well connected. And sometimes it also helps just talking to them after the meetup. And again, this is about networking and therefore essentially all about what I mentioned in our first, episode. A person who knows you is much more likely to make a decision in your favor. You're going to hear me repeat that sentence more often. So I hope this was enough stuff to think about. Again, online job search, social media, networking go hand in hand. Don't just rely on one of them. Instead, design your own strategy where you can combine linear and interactive methods, especially when it comes to exposure. Ask yourself, when are you going to the next meetup? which trade fairs are there in town this month? What are my goals for that day? And last, never underestimate the importance of networking. I'm sure at some point I'm going to release a podcast just on self-presentation skills and networking because so many people ask us how to do it right. Well, until then, my only piece of advice is throw yourself. What is more? And this is supposed to be some food for thought at the end. Recent studies show that up to 1/3 of graduates say they did not find a job in their field of expertise after graduation. In general, what we need is more data such as this. And this will also help us improve methods of pushing employability, especially when it comes to employment of graduates and young professionals. Institutional capacities, that's my personal opinion, play a very important role. And by that, I'm specifically addressing the schools, the universities. We at Africa Works provide consulting for higher educational institutions, and we've always witnessed that, unfortunately, career service centers often don't live up to their potential. And that's sad because they could. My experience, and we will have interesting podcasts on this specific issue, I'm sure, is that especially universities can be bridge builders, companies that in fact can more actively consider and use graduates as the unlimited talent pool that it is. For today, I hope your takeaway is not just to focus on what the internet shows you in terms of jobs. Don't just consume the jobs on the respective portals. There's more to job search and career development. Make it interactive. And maybe you want to make a few of my pieces of advice your homework. Hopefully the picture will become even clearer in our next episode, where I will be presenting you with the other side of the coin, the companies and the businesses' points of view. Thank you very much for listening, and